السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم. أما بعد, brothers and sisters, Alhamdulillah, we are spending the time in learning the Deen, which is one of the most important worship or good deeds. Inshallah, we hope that Allah Subhanahu wa Taala will reward for this time and for this learning. Inshallah. So we were learning important things minimum that a Muslim should learn and a Muslim should remember, because these are the pillars, minimum things about the Aqeedah. Then about the second thing, after saying La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, which is related to the faith and the belief, what is opposite of La ilaha illallah Tawheed, that is the shirk. We explain it briefly. Then we went for the prayer. So prayer, you know that there are some conditions. We mentioned the conditions of the prayer yesterday. Right now, yesterday when we say spiritual purity, that is the wudu and the ghusl. So wudu, you know how to make the wudu. We should learn, because without the proper wudu, prayer is not valid. Similarly, we should be in the major purity, that is the ghusl. That is also, we must know that when our ghusl breaks, we should know that, and it is mentioned in the ahadith and it is mentioned in the books of the fiqh. The scholar have mentioned, so when the person become spiritually impure, major impurity, minor impurity, so it should be removed. So major impurity is the person must take the bath. Minor impurity, person must make the wudu. So that is, you know that when a person pass the urine, feces, something from private parts, complete vomiting, all these things break the state of the wazoo. What break the ghusl is, you know, that ejaculation, physical relations of husband and wife, menses, confinement period after the delivery. So a woman has the bleeding, so they should take the bath after stopping of that bleeding, and after that happening, whatever it occurs, then they have to make the ghusl. So these are the major impurity. So that is called, you know, that spiritual purity. So this is conditions of the prayer. Yesterday we mentioned, after the conditions of prayer, prayer itself. For the prayer, to make it easy, simplify it, the scholar threw some technical words. Pillar, Rukunun, Arkan is the plural. Pillar, pillars. Rukunun, Arkanun. Rukun and Arkan means, pillar means we must observe to fulfill that pillar. Otherwise, the prayer become invalid if we miss the prayer pillar, or we have to make the, you know, neglect that rak'ah or that action, then we have to repeat it. Anyway, pillar means compulsory to do that. Then the second level, little bit lower level of the rukun is wajibat. You can ask why we have divided this way. The Prophet ﷺ performed the prayer, we have to perform. Yes. What the Prophet ﷺ performed is the 100% prayer, consisting of compulsory things, less than compulsory things, advisable things, that is we call fourth, fifth, Arkan, first level. Second level is wajibat, compulsory things. Third level is the mustahabbat, advisable things. Okay? So compulsory and obligatory things, that is pillars, if we miss it, we neglect it, we have to repeat, or we remember it after completing the prayer, then we have to repeat whole prayer. That is the pillars. That is important thing. Second thing in the wajibat that can be compensated with the sajda to sahu, to sajda, forgetfulness of prostration for forgetfulness. When we forget something, we make two sajda at the end of the prayer. That is the wajibah. There are the sunan. If you do it, you get the reward. If you don't do it, you don't get the reward. So a lot of things are there. So why we divided into three levels? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sometimes gave the concession for some mistakes. Sometimes he asked to make the forgetfulness of the prostration, or sometimes he asked the people to repeat the prayer. So scholars, they collected all the ahadith, all the rulings of the Prophet, and they concluded, they divided into important thing, less important thing. That is very important, which is done by the Prophet itself and the Sahaba. Okay, let us go for the arkan of the prayer. Arkan of the prayer, basically, if you try to remind 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, it might feel difficulty, but if you perform the prayer, you know that automatically all the arkan comes. What is the arkan? First, what you say? Allahu Akbar, isn't it? First takbir. In Arabic they say takbiratul ihram. Ihram means making haram. Or sometimes takbirat tahrima also they say in Urdu speaking circle. Tahrima means making haram. Why? Talking, eating, drinking, turning right, left, all these things become haram, isn't it? That is why that takbir make the prayer, start the prayer. Each and everything become haram. Takbiratul ihram, takbir tahrima. This is the first. You start the prayer. Okay? Then you recite the dua, you say Auzubillah, you bismillah, many things. But pillars means minimum, compulsory for the validity of the prayer. So after takbir tahrima, what do you do? Stand. Or you stand first, then you say takbir, both are okay. So standing is compulsory. Standing. Qumu lillahi qanitin. These are the verses, these are the ahadith. Stand. Qanitin. Qanitin means calm, cool, calm, worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the concentration. So standing. If a person can't stand, then it is allowed to him sit down. If he can't sit down, then he can lie and perform the prayer. Okay, but he is able to stand and he does not stand, then his prayer is not valid. This is on the obligatory prayer. 2 rakah of the Fajr, 4 rakah of the Zuhr, 4 rakah of the Asr, obligatory prayers. 3 rakah of the Maghrib, 4 rakah of the Isha. Okay, other than the obligatory, he can perform the prayer by sitting. But his reward become less. In the obligatory, he can't sit down. For example, the Prophet ﷺ, sometimes in the tahajjud, when he become aged, it is in the hadith that he used to sit down and perform the tahajjud prayer. Because tahajjud is not the obligatory prayer. Similarly, sunnah of the zuhur, sunnah of the asr, sunnah of the maghrib, or nafil prayer, whenever you want to perform the nafil prayers. Nafil prayer does not have any limit of the numbers, 2 plus 2 plus 2 plus 2 plus 2. You can perform any number. So for that, you can sit down and perform and you get less reward, half of the reward. While you're standing, full reward. If you sit down, half reward. That is in the hadith. So anyway, so 2 rukun I mentioned, 2 arkan. Takbiratul ihram and standing. Third is qiraatul fatiha. La salat liman lam yaqra bi fatihatil kitab. Lam yaqra bi fatihatil kitab. Whoever does not perform the Suratul Fatiha, his prayer is not valid. Allah said in the Quran, فَقْرَأُوا مَا تَيَسَّرَ مِنْ. Whatever it is possible, you recite the Quran. So whatever is possible, the scholars say, whatever possible means Suratul Fatiha. Understood? So minimum, that is why he mentioned in the beginning that each and every Muslim must memorize Suratul Fatiha in the first lesson. Did you understand why? Because we need it in each and every prayer. And also, Suratul Fatiha is minimum. More than that, You can recite one surah, two surah, one page, two page, 10 page, one juz, two juz. In the prayer, the longer you perform the prayer, the better, and you get more reward. So ruku, warqa'u ma'a dhaakin. Ruku, you know that, bowing. Then standing after the ruku, that means from the ruku you cannot go directly in the sajda, because one thing you are missing, that is after ruku you have to stand properly. Was sujood, then prostration, sajda on seven bones. Without the seven bones, seven limbs. Forehead with the nose. That means when you put your forehead on the earth, on the ground, your nose and your forehead should touch. Okay, one. Two hands. Two knees. Two foot, that is the fingers of the feet. So two feet, two knees, four, two palms, six, one is seven, nose, and this is the face. In the face, we need the forehead and the nose. So this is the sajda. So make sure that seven things should touch the ground. So when you are in the sajda, you get up completely. That is also compulsory. So when you get up, you sit down. Waljilsa. And tumanina fi jami' al-afal, that means you have to be comfortably you have to perform all these actions. It is not just, you know, that in a hadith, like a crow picking the seeds. Don't do that. So it should be properly. Also, the sequence should be there. And you cannot perform ruku first, then the qiyam. It is not. First, takbir, tahrima, then the qiyam, standing, then bowing, then standing from the ruku, then going to the sajda. So this is the sequence should be maintained. Okay. Then last, the shahud. If you are performing the two rakah, so in the second rakah, you sit down for the tashahud. Sitting down for the tashahud and reciting the tashahud and invoking blessings on the Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that also it comes, isn't it? So sitting in the last sajda and reciting the tashahud and invoking blessings on the Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you are performing the three rakah, it is in the third rakah. If you are performing the fourth rakah, it is in the fourth rakah, the tashahud. You cannot perform tashahud standing. Must sit down. That is one action, one rukun. Then recitation is the second rukun. And then you say, Assalamu alaikum rahmatullah, Assalamu alaikum rahmatullah. So, taslim. So, if you count it, it is 14. Some scholar might be, they mention these things. Sometimes they merge it, or sometimes they consider important, but not the rukun. So numbers will decrease. Maximum this is 14. You have to observe it. Simple. Okay. This is called Arkan. Okay. We did not mention Allahu Akbar while you are going the ruku. We did not mention Allahu Akbar while we are coming from the sajda. Sami Allahu liman hamida while we are raising from the ruku. We did not mention, isn't it? And also we did not mention Subhana Rabbil Ala, Subhana Rabbil Azim in the ruku, Subhana Rabbil Ala in the sajda. Something, isn't it? So this is the second level. That is called Wajibat. Wajibat is below the lower level of the pillars. Yeah, standing after the ruku, that is qiyam min ruku, they say, you know, standing from the ruku. At-tumanina is, tumanina means calm and comfortably you have to do the actions. It is not rushing, opposite of the rushing. So ruku should be properly. It is, you see some people, you know, that from the standing, they go ruku and they stand very fast. They don't perform the ruku as it should be. So that is called tumanina. So all the arkan, whatever we are performing, we should perform it calmly and with perfectly. That is called tumanina. Okay. Right now, the next level is the wajibat. So what is the wajibat, brothers and sisters? I said, you say Allah Akbar while you are going the ruku, isn't it? You say Samiallahu liman hamida while you are getting up from the ruku. So all these takbirat, after starting the prayer, not the first takbir, that is the rukun. After that, all the takbirat is considered wajib. For example, I perform Allahu Akbar, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim. I went to the ruku, I did not say Allahu Akbar. So I missed the wajib. What to do? Because you missed the wajib, you have to do two sajda at the end of the prayer. That is compensation for what we have missed from the wajibat. So takbirat is the from wajibat. Okay. Saying Samiallahu liman hamida also from the wajibat. For whom Samiallahu liman hamida? For the imam. And if a person is performing alone. Okay. For those who are following the imam, they should not say Samiallahu liman hamida. They should say Rabbana lakal hamd. Or Rabbana walak alhamd. Or Allahumma Rabbana walak alhamd. Lot of different wordings are there. Rabbana walak alhamd is a minimum. Okay. So they must say followers. Rabbana walak alhamd. Imam, and if a person is alone, see here. Yeah, once again I am repeating. I am talking about the wajibat. Okay. What are the wajibat for bowing ruku? For bowing or for going for the ruku, you say Allahu Akbar. It is wajib. Standing from the ruku, Sami Allahu liman hamida. If you are imam, you say Sami Allahu liman hamida. If you are performing alone, like a woman in the house or sunnah you are performing, so that same you say Sami Allahu liman hamida. If you are in the jama'ah, imam will say Sami Allahu liman hamida. Followers, they don't say Samiallahu liman hamida. They will say Rabbana lakal hamd. Followers. Is it clear? Okay. In the ruku, what do you say? Subhan Rabbil Azim. Minimum one time. Maximum, there is no limit. Maximum, there is no limit. If you don't say even one time Subhan Rabbil Azim, Fasabbih Bismi Rabbikal Azim, it is ordered in the Quran. If you don't say, then you miss the wajib, compulsory thing. In sajda, Sabbih isma rabbikal ala, Subhan rabbil ala. In the sajda. One time minimum, maximum any time, 10 times, 20 times, 100 times, 1000 times, you can say that. Generally, we teach the common public to say 3 times. Why? 3 times. Because one time is the singular. So we want to be minimum plural, that is the 3 in Arabic language. In English it is 2. In Arabic it is 3. So they say minimum 3 times you say. But what happened, you know, that we made it a habit to make it 3 times only. No. That is not a good idea. You should say as much as possible. Minimum 1 time, yes. Minimum perfectness is 3 times. Okay. Then you perform 2 sajda, isn't it? In between 2 sajda, you say Rabbi Ghfirli. And sometimes the other dua salo, Rabbi Ghfirli, Warhamni, Wahdini, Wa'afini, Warzuqni. Minimum Rabbi Ghfirli. Okay. If you are performing 3 raka or 4 raka, so there are 2 tashahud. First tashahud, first time you sit down for Attahiyatu Lillahi wa Salawatu. Second time also you sit down for Attahiyatu Lillahi wa Salawatu. So first time sitting is wajib. It means, for example, if you are in the second raka, while you are performing 3 raka like Maghrib, you forgot to sit down in the second raka, you stood. After standing, you will remember, oh, I did not sit down for the tashahud. So you can continue for the third raka. You make the sajda istahu at the end. 2 raka, this is compulsory, that is wajib, you missed it, you compensate with the two sajda. Okay, so first tashahud, and that tashahud also performed and recited while sitting. So sitting, first thing, reciting attahiyatu is second thing. This is the two things. So if you calculate all these things, what we have mentioned, these are wajibat. So it become eight wajibat. Okay, brothers and sisters. So there are the details. It is not the time. Inshallah, if you are with us in the second level, we will explain all these things. So Subhan Rabbil Azim, Subhan Rabbil Ala, one time minimum in the ruku, in the sajda, Rabbil Khilli between the two sajda, Attahiyatu Lillahi, reciting Attahiyatu in the second raka of the three raka or the four raka, and sitting for that, these are the wajibat. Okay. So in this eight wajibat, recitation of attahiyatu we said. So attahiyatu, there is different wordings and all are proof from the Prophet sallam, but commonly famous is Abdullah ibn Masood wording in India, that is attahiyatu lillahi wassalawatu wattayyibatu assalamu alayka ayyuhan nabiyyu wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh assalamu alayna wa ala ibadillahi salihin أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. This is the wording which is very famous. It is in the Sahih Bukhari, narrated from Abdullah ibn Masud, and there is from Abdullah ibn Abbas, there is from Abdullah ibn Umar. Every scholar or different areas scholar, they taken different wordings. All are in Sahih Ahadith, authentic Ahadith. So brothers, it is compulsory, isn't it? So we should memorize it or not? Yes. So did we make sure that our children memorize it? So please, in Ramzan, in coronavirus lockdown, sit down. Let our elders, might be our father, mother, we have to correct ourselves. There is no any embarrassment in learning the deen. Huh? The people, Abu Bakr Siddiq was in the age of the Prophet, younger than 2 years from the Prophet. His father was 20 years older than Abu Bakr. So he embraced Islam while he was around 80 years, so he was not able to walk. Abu Bakr bought him. So in that time, he learned from the Prophet ﷺ. So there is no embarrassment, brothers and sisters. This is the deen. Huh? We should not feel embarrassment. Or if you feel embarrassment to learn from the younger sirs, you search for someone who is in that age. For example, Alhamdulillah, I learn in Islamic madrasa, then I studied in Medina. I didn't not only graduation, post graduation, then I work in the fatwa center. My mother, she born in 1930, and she did not learn much. She used to raise in the village, and then she came to Hyderabad after getting married. Did not learn much. So I asked her that you learn from me. So she felt embarrassment. So I had a lady who was in her age. I said to her, how much do you charge? That time I'm talking about 20 years, 30 years back. So she said, I charge 200. I said that, okay, more than that, double, triple, I will pay. You come to my mother and teach her. So Alhamdulillah, she learned something. So that is the way we have to solve the problem, but it is compulsory. So I was teaching the whole world, whole people everywhere, Alhamdulillah, online somewhere. But I was not able to teach my mother. This is the nature. And also, when I reach and learn and work in Fatwa Center, International Fatwa Center for 10 years. So when I say something to my mother, she does not accept. And at the same time, my uncle was there. He was religious and known, elder than, but he was not also a scholar. But due to his akhlaq, adab, elder in the family, all the family used to respect him, except. So my mother listened to him. And whenever there is a question from my mother's side or some doubt, so it goes to him, my uncle. And uncle knows me, so he asked me first, called me alone somewhere and asked me what is the ruling of this thing. When I say, he says. So when he is telling, my mother is accepting. When I am telling, she is rejecting. Alhamdulillah. So my point is, brothers and sisters, we have to give importance to our deen, our religion, we must make sure that we learn the minimum important thing in our deen so that our prayer should be valid. Otherwise, subhanallah, on the day of judgment, it will be a great embarrassment, punishment. Might be Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will punish her. May Allah protect us. Okay, then you know that I did not reach to the sajda saho till this time. So let us go for salah ala nabi. So when you are sitting for the tashahud, okay, last tashahud, you must reach the tashahud and the salah ala nabi. That is in Urdu they say darud. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala ali Muhammadin kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka Hamidum Majid. Allahumma barik ala Muhammadin aw without Allahumma aw barik ala Muhammadin wa ala ali Muhammadin kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka Hamidum Majid. Very famous wordings. There are other wordings also. You can memorize whatever it is you know that convenient for you or you have memorized, continue in that. Okay. So brothers and sisters, these are the wajibat. In the tashahud al-akhir, which is pillar, first tashahud is only wajib. You miss tashahud al-akhir, so you have to repeat the fourth rakah. If you are still in the prayer, if you have forgot and you left, then you remember, oh, tashahud al-akhir, I did not do, then you have to repeat the prayer, isn't it? So in the tashahud al-akhir, you have to repeat, sit down, that is also compulsory. They said the tashahud and salah ala nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and make the dua also. So dua is any dua. Allahumma inni zalamtu nafsi zulman kaseeran wa la yaghfiru dhunuba illa ant. So this is very famous dua. Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu used to recite and the Prophet taught him. There is another hadith. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min azabi jahannam wa min azabi al-qabr wa min fitnati al-mahya wa al-mamat wa min fitnati al-masih al-dajjal. So scholars say, this is more authentic and more beneficial. You have to recite it. Anyway, any dua that is possible. Okay. Scholars, they mention Allahumma a'inni ala dhikrika wa shukrika wa husni ibadatik. And similar duas are there. Okay, sisters. So there is a question which is not related to my topic, but still I will answer. Sajdatu sahu. Two sajda. Two sajda, there is details, but in Sahih Muslim, if you go for the chapter of the prayer and chapter of sajda of forgetfulness, you will get in Sahih Muslim, and Sahih Muslim is all the ahadith are authentic. Sometimes the Prophet ﷺ performed two sajda before making the salam. Sometimes he performed two sajda after making the salam. Both are correct. Okay, so no problem for that. Afwan, sorry. The question is, if you make the mistake, see here, brother, first of all, we have to decide where we are making the mistake. Not every time you make the two sajda. I told you, arkan, you know that khiyam is the rukun, ruku is the rukun. For example, in the second raka, you missed the ruku, you forgot. In second raka. So you are in the third raka. That time you remember, oh, second raka I did not perform the ruku. So you are third raka, second raka, all are invalid. You come once again for the second raka. You start from the second raka. Then the third raka, then the fourth raka. Okay. Because you made the mistake, you make the sajda sahu. That is, this sajda sahu is just for the mistake. But the prayer is completely you have to perform. Okay. You miss the ruku in the second raka, you finish the prayer and then you remember, oh, I did not perform ruku in the second raka. That is the rukun. Ruku is the rukun. So you have to perform once again the whole prayer, repeat the whole prayer. This is about the arkan. Okay. What about the wajibat? Wajibat, you have to make the sajda sahu. That's it. Not repeating. For example, in the first raka, you did not say Subhana Rabbil Azim in the ruku. You remember it after the ruku. continue. Just make the sajda sahu end of the prayer. That's it. Whatever the wajibat is there. For example, you are in the second raka. You forgot it, you stand. You stood for the third raka. You cannot go back. Don't go. You continue third raka, fourth raka. Because you missed the second in second raka, tashahud. So you make two sajda. That is the wajibat. This is mistake. Other than wajibat, other than the arkan, mistakes. For example, subhanaka allahumma bihamdika shudal in the beginning. We Allahum ba'id baini wa baina khataaya kama ba'adta baina al-mashriqi wa subhanaka allahumma wa tabaraka ismuka wa ta'ala jadduka wa la ilaha ghayruka is dua or another dua or some duas you did not perform. So you will see that this kind of the mistakes is just sunnah. Just it is advisable. Just it is rewardable. So if you miss it, you don't get the reward, but your prayer is valid. So we categorize the mistake in three levels. Accordingly, we will give the ruling. This is all the fatwa, all the scholars, they do in this way. Hopefully, I am clear. Okay. So third level is, that is called mustahabbatus salah. Advisable, preferable. Sometimes it is called sunanus salah. Sunnah is in the fiqh. Sunnah means which is not obligatory, which is not rukun. In general speeches, when we sunnah, that is the what the Prophet did. General, Prophet Sallam perform, you know that he ate the dates or he ate the turban or he performed all these things considered sunnah, whatever he practiced. Sajda in the sajda sahu, Subhan Rabbil Ala, you say Subhan Rabbil Ala, nothing else. Or the duas which is recited in the sajda. Lot of duas are there. Subhanakallah, subbuhun khuddusun rabbuna wa rabbul malaikat wa dhu subhanakallah wa bihamdika allahumma gfirli. So subhanakallah Allah is enough. So right now the third level. Advisable actions or it is called sunanus salah. Sunnah of the salah. Sunnah means here not the what the Prophet did. Sunnah means here which is not obligatory. And it is done by the Prophet ﷺ. So first thing is the after you saying Allahu Akbar, you recite A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Rajeem and you say Bismillah Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim and then you recite no. After saying Allahu Akbar, you recite Allahumma ba'id baini wa baina khataaya. Then you say A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Rajeem. Then you say Bismillah. Then you say Alhamdulillah. Isn't it? So here the dua, which is called dua ul istiftah. It means dua of beginning of the prayer. So there are a lot of duas. So whatever the dua you can recite, you get the reward. If you forget, nothing is due on you. No repeating of the prayer or no sajda tu sahu. That means sajda of forgetfulness. Nothing. So this is the dua. A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Rajeem. Bismillah Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Also, putting the hands might be put on the chest or below or that. More authentic, very authentic ahadith are there which shows that it is on the chest. Okay. But you did not put it or forgot it. Your hand is there. So, not compulsory to make sajda sahu or to repeat it. It is among the sunnah of the prayer according to all the majority of the scholars. Okay. Well, you are going the ruku, you make the raful yadain. When you go to the ruku, when you get up from the ruku, and when you stand after the second raka. So raful yadain, they say, raising two hands. For takbir at-tahrim also, you raise the hands. That is also sunnah. That means, if you don't raise the hand, it's okay. If you raise, you get the reward. If you don't raise, you will not be punished. You won't be punished. And nothing is due on you. Also, I said one time tasbih is compulsory in the ruku and the sajda. More than one is sunnah. That means you get the reward if you say more than one time. Did you get, brothers and sisters? Dua, saying auzubillah, saying bismillah. Okay. And raising the hands and placing the right hand on the left hand. All are sunnah of the prayer. That means if you do that, you get the reward. Otherwise, your prayer is valid. tasbih more than one time, subhana rabbil ala, subhana rabbil azim. Also between two sajda we say rabbi ighfirli, minimum. More than that it is the sunnah, rabbi ighfirli warhamni wahdini wa'afini warzuqni. And after the ruku we say rabbana walakal hamd, minimum. More than that is the sunnah, rabbana walakal hamd hamdan kaseeran tayyiban warakan fi. Sometimes allahumma lakal hamd mil as-samawati wa mil al-ard wa mil ma shi'ta min shay'in, but lot of dua the prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did. Also in the ruku, your head and your back should be flat. Don't bow the head too much. Don't raise the head too much. Not this way. Flat. So this is the sunnah of the Prophet. More or less is not the sunnah. You don't get the reward of following the sunnah of the Prophet while you are doing. And sajda also, putting the seven things. But still the Prophet ﷺ performed the sajda while his hands were lit away from his body and his thighs were not touching his stomach. So this is the perfect sunnah. More or less is okay. That is also sajda, acceptable. But sunnah sajda, is, this is what the way I said. Okay. So these are the sunnah actions. Also, in the second sajda, in the second rakah, between the sajda, in the fourth sajda, how do you sit down? You can sit anyway. You can sit down on your feet, but you flat your left feet and erect your right feet. That is better. That is the sunnah. But more or less, prayer is valid. Also, in the fourth rakah, you sit down on your hip, your left leg should go under the right leg, isn't it? So you can sit down on the hip, you know that. That is also sunnah, but if you don't sit like that, it's okay, the prayer is okay, acceptable. Also, attahiyatu lillahi, so moving the finger, gesturing the finger, or just gesturing, or just moving, whatever it is, all are acceptable. That is also sunnah. Even someone does not move and does not gesture, just attayatulillahi wassalat, he did not move and did not raise, it's okay, acceptable. If he does move or raise, he get extra reward because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did it. So at, you know that in the last rak'ah, that is whether it is the second rak'ah or the third rak'ah or fourth rak'ah, attahiyatu is compulsory. And invoking blessing on the Prophet ﷺ is compulsory, isn't it? Then there is a dua, Allahumma inni zalamtu nafsi zulman kaseeran, or something like that. This dua is not compulsory. Just invoking and attahiyatu is compulsory. Dua, you can do that or you leave it, no problem. That is considered as the sunnah action. Because dua is for ourselves. Other things is to follow the Prophet ﷺ. Here, I would like to just, it is not related to this, but remind that I remember this hadith. The Prophet ﷺ said, As-salamu alayka ayyuhan nabiyyu wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. As-salamu alayna wa ala ibadillahi s-salihin. Oh Allah, peace be on us and on all the righteous people, ibadillahi s-salihin. Subhanallah. You know that what is the in the hadith, Sahih Bukhari? When the person says, peace be on me and all the righteous people, it covers each and every good person in the whole world. So brothers, always we are bothering about, we request the people to make dua for me. But here the Prophet said that you become righteous, you get the dua each and every time, whoever is performing the prayer, sunnah, obligated prayer, everywhere in the world. Subhanallah, Allah is so merciful. Allah is so merciful, subhanallah. So I was mentioning and the sunnah of the dua. See here, in the fajr, we recite the Quran loudly, isn't it? When we are in the jama'ah or we are individual. But if someone is in individual, he does not recite loudly, that his prayer is valid because he recited the Quran, but just he did not raise his voice. So raising the voice or loudly the citation is just a sunnah action. That if he does in the obligatory prayers, so he will be rewarded. Otherwise, his prayer is valid, not compulsory. So same thing applied to Fajr, Maghrib, Isha, and Juma and the Eden prayer. So, okay. So right now there are a little bit more sunnah. I will finish it, then I go for the question answer. Similarly, in the Zuhr and Asr, reciting silently or secretly is sunnah. If somebody recite loudly, it's okay. Prayer is valid, but it is not sunnah. Okay. Also, more than Suratul Fatiha is sunnah. If a person just recite Fatiha, it is okay. More than that, it is sunnah. He get more reward for that. These are the some things which is sunnah actions. Brothers and sisters, if you know these levels, we will not fight and we will not hate each other for doing some mistakes, because we can accept it more or less, because we know that his prayer is valid. Minimum, we try to teach him extra because you have extra knowledge. He does not have. But it is not a matter of fighting, and it is not the matter of hating. So hopefully I explained it. Right now the session of the question and answer session. May Allah bless all of you. Jazakumullah khair. So any question, brother? The question is that females, when they are performing alone, so do they need the ikhama to perform for the obligatory prayer or not? That is the question. No, not compulsory. Ikhama is not necessary. No need, no, not required. Why? Because the ikhama is to call the people to establish the prayer. So right now you are performing alone, so no need of that ikhama for the women. Yeah, it is the sunnah to perform Fajr, Maghrib and Isha loudly, even you are performing alone. But basically, when the Jama'ah and you are living nearby, male should go there. And the female, when there is a mahram only, they can loudly recite. If there are no mahram, the other people also there, they should recite secretly. That means lowering their voice. My Muslim friend, those people who reject the ahadith completely, and those people they don't accept the ahadith completely, it is a new group. They are called themselves Ahlul Quran. They say the Quran is sufficient for us. These people are not Muslims. They are out of Islam. We cannot say them Muslims at all. Because when they don't follow the sunnah of the Prophet, then how do they perform the prayer? How they know what is Islam, what is the deen? Lot of things. Because Allah said in the Quran, O Prophet, you explain the Quran to them. So hadith is the explanation. وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ ذِكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ. So these people are not Muslims, basically. That is why they don't perform the prayer. Also, Ahlul Quran, they don't perform the prayer. They don't perform the janazah prayer. They don't pay the zakat, a lot of things, because they don't follow the sunnah. And most of the Ahlul Quran, I never saw any Ahlul Quran to perform the hajj also. So these people, when they left the sunnah, they started explaining the Quran by themselves. So they are non-Muslims. So marrying them or considering them part of the Muslim Ummah is wrong. This is the unanimous opinion and fatwa of the scholars. So brothers, you try him to understand the sunnah and let him to believe in that. Otherwise, we cannot consider them as the believers, Muslims. Yeah. Whenever there is a husband and wife, the wife should stand behind the husband, not beside her, beside him. And the ikhama is given by the husband, because the male, when they are performing the fard prayer, alone also, they should give the ikhama. Though it is not compulsory, but it is advisable. So there is a question, when you forget one complete rak'ah in the prayer. So when did you remember that you miss one rakah. For example, you are performing 3 rakah of the Maghrib. You make the salam in the second rakah itself. And somebody said, Subhanallah. Or somebody said, you know, you miss one rakah. Just you stand that same time, perform one rakah. Then you make the sajda sahu, and then you say the taslim right and left. Salaam alaikum wa rahmatullah. Okay. If the same time, for example, if you perform 2 rakah, then you went to the washroom, and then you went to the market, and then you cook something 5-10 minutes, then you talk in the worldly matters, then you remember, or somebody told. So right, that time you have to repeat whole prayer. Whole 3 rakah you have to perform, because in the first situation, you remember just after making the mistake. In the second, there was a lot of gap between second rakah and the third rakah, so you cannot perform the third rakah. So you have to repeat complete there. So one sister is answering while the people are asking the questions. Why? I don't know. Why? Who gave her, you know, that... this responsibility. Don't do that. Even if you know that, you keep quiet, because it is the deen. Part of the akhlaq is that when you are learning from the teacher, so let the teacher to speak. And also, I will advise the people that please don't rush to give the fatwa, because you are talking about the deen or teaching the people. You are, when you are consulted, if you know 100% something, and there is no more knowledgeable person in your area, in your community, or in your place, then you inform him, this is what I have learned from the scholar, or it is in the Quran, in the Hadith, that is understood. You convey, that's it, not more than that. What happened, you know, a lot of times, not clear things also conveyed by the common public, who are not the don't have the specialization in the Quran and the Sunnah. So sisters, please, it is not the matter of showing that you have the knowledge. If you have the knowledge, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bless in your knowledge, inshallah, and you be humble. Don't try to show, might be my words are a little bit direct for you, but it is deen. This is the advice given to us, and that is the advice I'm giving you. Sorry for that if I'm hurting you, but you make a habit of not attending the people question, except when it is needed, first thing. Second thing is that, you know, that whatever it is not clear in the Quran and the Sunnah, we cannot deduce the ruling. Even if it is the fatwa given for Sheikh bin Baz, or somewhere you have learned on the internet, that fatwa also, it is a legal language, it is the religious language, you have to understand properly to implement somewhere. So that is why we should avoid it. And also we have to refer, because Prophet ﷺ said, anyone who says something about me and he make the mistake, then his about is hellfire. That is what the Prophet ﷺ said. So avoid it. So it is not allowed. Try to in the control and refer to the scholar. If you know that somebody is making the mistake, at that time also you have to refer to the knowledgeable person. May Allah make the matters easy and give her the taqwa and the fear of Allah and the humbleness. So please don't answer and don't rush to give the answers to the people. Okay, brothers? Umar Razi Allahu Anhu, the question is that sometimes we, you know, we scratch our body, sometimes, you know, touch our body, moving hands. So that is the question. What is the ruling? Umar Razi Allahu Anhu says, when he saw the person moving his hand in the during the prayer, he said, Khushu, Walladheena hum fi salatihim khashi'un. Allah says the khushu. Khushu means concentration and submission. So the Prophet, his heart have the khushu, then his limbs would not move. So it is the lack of the khushu. The people, when they are, you know, that scratching and moving, that means they are not concentrating and not dedicated for the prayer. So it is the reward become less. So we should avoid it. Sorry? Congregational dua. Somebody is asking, for example, you perform the obligatory prayer, then you raise the hand and the people say the Ameen, congregational prayer. So congregational prayer is congregational dua. Yes, sorry, not the prayer means the salah. Congregational dua, that is the prayer also or the supplication. Congregational dua is not allowed in the sense the Prophet did not do that. So, but it is highly recommended after obligatory dua. But the congregational dua, there sometimes you are gathering and Salatul Istisqa, Juma, sometimes the Prophet make the dua, that is allowed. But after the obligatory prayer, 5 times we perform the prayer. Then after each prayer, the Imam Sahib raise the hands and make the dua and the people say the Amin. That is not part of the Sunnah and it should be avoided. Individually, the people should do the dua. Istikhara prayer is not our part of the syllabus. Might be we'll deal it later, inshallah. Yeah, bolenge, no problem. The people are asking about the whether there is a difference in the sajda of male and the female. Many people ask. See here, there is no difference between the sajda of male and the female because the structure of the prayer and the description of the prayer is common. But according to the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, the women prayer in the house is better than performing in the masjid, first thing. In the house also, the Prophet ﷺ mentioned 3 levels. In the angan, you know that courtyard, you say veranda, out of the house. The prayer there, if the woman perform, so if she perform in the dining room, it is better than the veranda. Okay. From the dining room, then his bedroom, when nobody, closet room, nobody enters, that is better. Why? Because when she performs the ruku and the sajda, body shape and the curves is seen. So scholar, what they say, because right now the women are not observing all these things, and they say minimum sunnah sajda is to touch what? 7 limbs, forehead and the nose, hands, knees and the feet. So it is touching, but they say the women can perform on the thighs and cover her sides with the hands. So they come up with this idea, Imam Shafi Rahmatullah Alayhi's followers, Imam Abu Hanifa's followers, some of the Salafi scholars' followers also. They say sajda is sajda. This is the sajda is also valid sajda. So you can say that some sunnah of the sajda is missing, but sajda is 100% valid. So that is why we should not fight each other that the women who are performing the sajda by touching the thighs and the stomach to their thighs and touching the hands, they are doing the mistakes. No. Especially if they are performing in front of the other people or it is not in the closet room, even in front of the you know, the mahram little bit, you know, that it looks, if it's not properly covered, so shapes of the body, that is why they say this sajda should be in this way. So the sajda is valid. The proper is the sunnah sajda is, what is the sunnah sajda? So I told you in the beginning itself, for the sunnah, we should not fight because the fighting is haram. Hatred is haram. Splitting is haram. So it is a major mistakes. For the major mistakes, you know that, we should not neglect the simple, you know, that for the simple things, we should not commit the major mistakes. So that is, I would like to say that. So sunnah is not different, but those who are performing this way, sunnah is this, sajda is not different between the male and the female sajda. The female who are performing the sajda on this own way, that is what I said, they are meeting the minimum requirement of the sajda, that is why their sajda is valid. Hopefully it is clear. So I told you, I promise, inshallah, make dua. Soon we are going to announce a webinar of the zakat. So inshallah, you can ask all the questions about the zakat, inshallah. In 2 days, in 3 days. So also tasbih prayer and the istikhara prayer, all these things we will discuss later, inshallah. Anything question? Okay, tomorrow also, please inform your friends. We are looking, the numbers are decreasing right now. Why, I don't know. You people want the stories and, you know, the jokes. No, this is the deen. Learn, be serious, and it remains with you. And call your friends also once again to participate in our lectures. Ameen. May Allah bless all of you. Ameen. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.